गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न और गो थ्रू वन ऑफ द अनदर चैप्टर्स फ्रॉम योर बुक द फ्लैमिंगो. दिस इज़ द सेकेंड प्रोज दैट यू हैव इन योर बुक एंड द नेम इज़ द लॉस्ट स्प्रिंग स्टोरीज ऑफ स्टोलन चाइल्डहुड एंड इट्स रिटन बाय अनीस चंग. ओके, सो लेट्स क्विकली मूव फॉरवर्ड एंड सी एज वट वी कम अक्रॉस एज वी गो थ्रू द चैप्टर. ओके, now first learn something about Anish Jung. Anish Jung is the author of the story of the lost spring, the stories of Cholan and stolen childhood. She was born in Rourkela. Anish hails from an aristocratic family in Hyderabad. Her father Nawab Hoshiyar Jung was a renowned scholar and poet and served as the mushahib or advisor to the last Nizam prince of Hyderabad state. Her mother and brother are also noted Urdu poets. After schooling and college at Osmania University in Hyderabad, she went to the United States for higher studies at University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, where she did her master's in sociology and American studies. Okay, so this is a small info about the author herself. She started her career in writing with the Youth Times, a Times of India publication, where she worked as a journalist and the editor 1976 to 1979. She has subsequently worked for the Christian Science Monitor and International Herald Tribune. Anish Jung lives in Delhi. Jung came into the limelight with the publication of Unveiling India in 1987. See one of the snapshot I have given over here of her book Unveiling India. It is one of her most noted work, which is a travel diary focusing on interviews with women. She has written several subsequent books on the same, talking to women about their everyday lives, including Night of the New Moon, Encounters with Muslim Women in India, Seven Sisters, Breaking the Silence, and Beyond the Courtyard. Okay, and these books were published in different times, as you can see over here. So this is all about the author. Now quickly let's move into our story. This is the story called The Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood. We'll first see what is the theme of the story. Now Anish Jung's The Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood focuses on children from deprived backgrounds and includes the stories of Idris, a child who is kidnapped and forced to work in the carpet industry in Mirzapur. Others are maltreated by alcoholic fathers or married off early for sexually abused, though some find refuge in schools set up by well-meaning NGOs. Jung is noted for a lively and vivid description, as an excerpt of this book is taken for your syllabus. Now, see over here, there is a picture that I have included over here. Now, I have already told you countless number of times since last year that often these authors or poets, they have the tendency to denote the phases of a human's life through different seasons. See over here, you can see that spring is being considered, or spring is something that denotes the childhood of a human being. Then autumn is something that denotes the middle age of one human being. Then comes summer. Summer means the youth. And then finally the winter, or the old age. Okay, so I have also told you in other stories, for example, if you remember in My Mother at 66, where the poetess over here compares her mother with late winter's moon. Okay, I had told you countless times that yes, it is a tendency among the authors and the poets to do so, because it is their literary style to work accordingly and explain the phases of human life through different seasons that in a year. And here the author, the story of the lost spring, means here the stories of lost childhood. Okay, spring means lost childhood. It means over here, not the season spring etymologically. Okay, so the story lost spring describes the pitiable condition of poor children who have been forced to miss the joy of childhood due to the socio-economic condition that prevails in this man-made world. These children are denied the opportunity of schooling and forced into labor early in life. So this speaks a lot about a very sensitive thing that is being prevalent, a very big crime that is prevalent right now in India, and this is called the child labor. These children are denied the opportunities of schooling and forced into labor early in life. Anish Jung gives voice to eliminate child labor by educating the children and to enforce the laws against child labor by the government strictly. Now, if you go through, if you Google out, there are hundreds of laws that are being, that are drafted, hundreds of acts are being drafted to stop this child labor. Even there is one powerful act that is banning child labor throughout India, but unfortunately we can see young children even below who are 14 years of age working in different sectors as laborers, and this is one of the black mark that we have on our society. This called something a kala dhabba on our society, which is extremely pervert, which is extremely bad, which is extremely exploiting for the child. Mainly, it is something that exploits the childhood of a person, and this will shape how this person grows up in future. The call is to end child exploitation and let the children enjoy the days of the spring that bring joy under their feet. Now, this is the theme of the story. Okay? Now let's move into the story itself. Firstly, I would like to inform you one thing, that this story is being divided into two parts. The first part is called Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage. This story is about a rag picking section of the society, the life of the rag pickers in a place in Delhi. The second story is I Want to Become a Driver. Okay, and this is story about a man who is born into the bangle makers community of Firozabad and what he faces in his life. This two stories are different parts that is included in the same story. Now, first part we will go through. The first part is Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage, part one. This is the part one of the story. Why do you do this? I asked Shahib, whom I encounter every morning scrounging for gold in the garbage dumps of my neighborhood. Sahib left his home long ago, set amidst the green fields of Dhaka. His home is not even a distant memory. There were many storms that swept away the fields and homes, his mother tells him. That's why they left, looking for gold in big city where he now lives. Now, from the very line onwards, you can understand that these people who have become ultimately the rag-picking society of Delhi are nothing but the refugees that have taken shelter due to various problems they had faced and mostly these people hail from our neighboring country of Bangladesh. Like this boy called Shahib, whom the narrator talks to. Narrator is being informed by Shahib that they have come from a place called Dhaka, that is the capital of Bangladesh, where they had their own land, where they were the native of Dhaka, but due to some economic and natural conditions they could not stay there, because every time their fields were swept away by storms and thunderstorms and everything, and their villages were ruined by the storms, and they had to look elsewhere to earn their bread. That is why what they did, they came into the neighboring country of India and traveled to Delhi to become the rag pickers. Okay, that's why they left looking for gold in the big city where he now lives. Now hear the word gold. If you see here the word gold, this is not literally gold. Okay, do not consider as they have think that they have come over here to purchase gold or get gold. Here gold means what? To earn living, to earn their livelihood, to earn money, to earn happiness. They have come to a big city. They are being told that if you go to a big city, you can earn your happiness, you can earn your living, you can become a big man one day. That is why they have stepped forward. They have left their country where they are being tormented by the natural calamities day after day, and they have come to Delhi to look for their livelihood. I have nothing else to do, he mutters, looking away. Go to school, I say gibbly, realizing immediately how hollow the advice must sound. There is no school in my neighborhood. When they build one, I will go. If I start a school, will you come? I ask, half joking. Now here the author tells that why are you doing all this? Then Sahib replies by saying, I have nothing else to do. Then at a moment, something comes out of the author's mouth. What? Something comes out of the author's mouth saying that, yes, why don't you go to school? Then Sahib replies very discreetly. He says that we don't have a school in our neighborhood. If they ever build one, I'll definitely love to go one day. Now, the author also feels sorry by saying all these things, you know, because she also knows that giving such an hollow advice to a rag picker is something that is absurd, very absurd for, because these people, they cannot even earn their living leave about education. Okay. Half jokingly, the author says, this boy, that if I ever make a school, will you come and join it? And he says definitely, and he smiles broadly. That means he always want to go to school. Unlike other children, he don't want to spend his life looking into the garbage for something that he needs to do to earn his living. He, like a child, he wants to get dressed up in school dress, wants to have new books, wants to read, wants to study, want to become something like every child dreams of. But he is being bound to walk into this situation, and that is why when the author says that, yes, if I build one day any school, will you go and join it? And the boy replies by saying that, yes, definitely, I will do so. A few days later, I see him running up to me. Is your school ready? It takes longer to build a school, I say, embarrassed at having made a promise that was not meant. Now, this boy, he's so innocent. He's a little boy. He thinks, and his life is very simple, you know. He doesn't understand all these big complexities of life. He goes up to the author and says, okay, is your school built? Did you build it? Now, am I ready to read in the school or not? And then the author, she's herself embarrassed and says that, okay, you know, it takes longer to build a school. So you come back after some days. Let me see what can I do for you. But promises like mine abound in every corner of his bleak world. Now, this is not only about the author. You know, we also make a lot of promise to people around us. Mainly, see, the people who are bound to make the legislature of the country, who are bound to look after the people of the country, that is the government. The government also, day after day, makes lots of promise, mainly to the deprived and the destitute part of the country, part of the society, saying that they will provide them with basic amenities, they will provide them with basic education, they will provide with all the necessities of life that they need to survive in this land. But how much they can fulfill, is something that is a $1 million question. That is what the author says here, that this kind of promises are in every corner of this bleak world. After months of knowing him, I asked him his name. Sahib-e-Alam, he announces. He does not know what it means. If he knew its meaning, Lord of the Universe, he would have hard time believing it. So, the actual name of Sahib is what? Sahib-e-Alam. Please guys, underline this name, because this, you're going to get a question out of here. You'll be asked, what is the full name of Sahib? Don't write all these stupid things. Just write Sahib-e-Alam. See how the spelling is being done. Okay? And what is this name means? He declares his name is Sahib-e-Alam. The author herself gets embarrassed and feels guilty. You know, this little boy, he doesn't know the meaning of his name. And if he did, then he would have hard time to believe it. He could not believe that his mother or father had, or any one of his family would have named him with such a name that is extremely contrary today to his life. What the name of his, what is his name mean? It means the Lord of the Universe. Unaware of what his name represents, he roams the street with his friends, an army of barefoot boys who appear like morning birds and disappear at noon. So this boy, Sahib-e-Alam, is not the only person, only little boy who is actually walking around picking up rags from different garbage areas. You know, there are numerous boys and they all move in a team, like in a group, walking from one place to another, looking for things in a garbage that they can sell off and earn their living. And these army of boys, as the author says, they are formed in a group and they all walk barefoot from one place to another. They appear in the morning and by the noontime, you cannot see them. They disappear because their work is done by noontime and they return home by then. Over the months, I have come to recognize each of them. Why weren't you wearing chappals? I asked one. My mother did not bring them down from the shelf, he answers simply. So another boy is there whom the author speaks to. Now she speaks to every one of this army of boys who pick rags, you know. And to one boy he questions that why aren't you wearing a shoe? Why aren't you wearing a chappal? Then he readily answers saying that I have one. My mother had kept it up on the shelf. That means... See, we have so many shoes at home, so many clothes at home. Still, we throw tantrums. If you need to go anywhere, you throw tantrums that, Mom, I need to buy one more dress. I need good shoes along with it, to go along with it. But this boy, he knows that he have only one pair of shoes that his mother keeps so that they can go at certain, you know, special occasion. And she does not allow her son to wear that shoe often because it is going to ruin. Even if she did, he will throw them off, adds another who is wearing shoes that do not match. And there is another boy who is wearing shoes, but they are of two different types. And he says that, yes, if your mother even give you shoes, you are going to throw it off. Because, why? Because these boys are not accustomed for wearing shoes. They are accustomed wearing, walking bare feet across the street. When I comment on it, he shuffles his feet and says nothing. I want shoes, says a third boy who has never owned a pair all his life. Now, I think here the author, she is telling about, firstly comes about, she talks about education. Now, education is definitely the basic needs of anyone's life. But think of what are the basic needs of anyone's life. First, it is clothes, then your food and shelter. These three are called the basic requirements of life. Now, these people, these young children, they don't even have the basic requirements of life. Forget about education. Education is something that is heavenly for them. That is something that is that will be born out of divine touch. That is something can Goddess Saraswati can only give them an opportunity to do so. Forget about all this. They cannot even afford shoes. One boy, he is walking barefoot. He says that his mother does not allow him to wear shoes. He have one pair and she keeps it up on the shelf. Never gives her own, except only on special occasions. Then another boy is there who is wearing a pair of shoes, but that are mismatched. Two different types. Third boy is there who says that I have never owned any pair of shoes throughout my life and I want one. So these are the conditions of the little children who are walking there. Okay. Traveling across the country, I have seen children walking barefoot in cities on village roads. It is not lack of money, but a tradition to stay barefoot is one explanation. I wonder if this only is an excuse to explain away a perpetual state of poverty. Now, if you go to interior parts of the country, interior parts of the community, you will see people have the habit to walk barefoot and they will readily declare that, yes, it is their way of living. It is the status they live, that they have lived throughout. Yeah, they are not accustomed to wear shoes. They consider walking barefoot as something very holy. You can even hear it from your parents. You can ask them. They will say, yes, walking barefoot is something very holy to some parts, in some parts of the country. Now, the author, she cautions herself as well. She cautions a reader. Is this something that is given as an excuse to explain away the perpetual state of poverty that is prevalent throughout the country? We are just making an excuse to remain barefoot. We are just saying that it's a custom of ours to stay barefoot just because we could not buy a pair of shoes for everyone. Is this something like this? Okay, guys. So we will stop till here. Next day, we will continue from the next portion.